Hello, everybody. Welcome to episode number 87 of the BeerSmith podcast. It's late August 2014, and this week we're going to be talking about lagers. Today's podcast is sponsored by Craft Beer and Brewing Magazine, the newest magazine on beer brewing. Every issue is packed with great advice on brewing techniques, beer styles, home brewing, and craft beer brewing. Go to beerandbrewing.com and use the offer code BeerSmith to get a 20% discount. Again, use the coupon code BeerSmith to get a 20% discount on your magazine subscription at beerandbrewing.com. And the American Homebrewers Association Forum at homebrewersassociation.org. Join 22,000 fellow brewers discussing beer brewing, troubleshooting, and more. You can also access it from the Tapatalk app on your mobile device. The forum is free to join. Just go to homebrewersassociation.org to sign up today. And also, BeerSmith Mobile for your phone, iPad, or tablet device. Create new beer recipes on the go, share them with your friends, or search from tens of thousands of existing recipes on the BeerSmith Cloud. BeerSmith Mobile is available for iPhone, iPad, Android, or Kindle Fire from the iTunes, Google Play, or Amazon App Store. Grab your copy today. And now let's move on to this week's episode. Today on the show, I welcome John Bolton and Dave Carpenter to talk about lagers. John Bolton is the CEO and publisher for Craft Beer and Brewing Magazine. John previously built a multi-million dollar publishing business, which was acquired in 2007, and has now made the transition from traditional publishing to mixed media. His new focus is beer. John, it's great to have you on the show.
Well, thank you for having me, Brad. I'm very excited to be here.
So you're in Fort Collins, right? Is that right?
Fort Collins, Colorado, correct.
Fantastic. And we also have Dave Carpenter. He's contributing editor for Craft Beer and Brewing Magazine. He's an MIT grad who left aeronautical engineering to pursue a career in writing and home brewing. He's an avid home brewer, editor of the Cheers Fort Collins blog, and has written for Zymergy as well as Craft Beer and Brewing Magazine. Dave, it's great to have you on the show.
Great to be here. Thanks for having us, Brad. Looking forward to it.
So when were you at MIT?
I graduated in 2000.
2000, that's a little bit after me. I was a fellow there in Draper Labs in, 91 or 92, somewhere around there.
Oh, sure, over near Kendall Square.
Yeah, right next to Kendall Square, exactly. Anyways, great to have you both on the show. And I see you have in the background there, you have a little brewing system.
Yeah, this is our test pilot system. It's a 15-gallon all-electric, and we use it for testing some of the recipes that go into our magazine.
Yeah, in fact, we used it yesterday, so it's a great system. It's something that we've been using for a while, and it's fortunately we're allowed to do it, even though we're on the second floor. Thank goodness for the. For the electrical type systems in this particular case, because propane probably wouldn't have cut it.
That's awesome. So you guys are at the magazine offices and you got your own little brewing system.
Correct.
And today we're going to talk a little bit about lagers. And so John, I wanted to start with you and ask you a little bit about what are some of the trends that you're seeing in craft beer and in home brewing for lagers?
Sure. We're seeing, a very exciting time for lagers. I think lagers is something that always people have enjoyed. But the trends for the IPAs that have happened over the last few years has started to resonate all over into the lagers. So personally, I'm seeing a lot of lagers that are being hopified and a lot of hops added to it. The IPLs and double IPLs are very popular, in addition to the fact I really feel like it gives the opportunity for the brewer, both home brewer and pro brewer, to kind of differentiate themselves among other brewers, because it's complex and difficult to brew, but at the same time, the rewards are great.
Fantastic. Dave, what about home brewing? You're seeing some new trends in lagers and home brewing as well, right?
Yeah, I think lagers are a little bit where ales were, three decades ago, in that there's kind of this rediscovery of lager styles taking place. I think a lot of the ale-centric growth of home brewing and pro brewing was maybe even a reaction against lesser lagers, but people are rediscovering the joys of lager and brewing them in new ways. So similar to what John said, a lot of home brewers are really hopping up their lagers. The India Pale Lager is definitely one of the more popular styles the unique properties of lager strains really allow the hops to come through even more so than you might get with a clean ale strain. I've also seen a little bit of experimentation with souring and with Brettanomyces used after the primary lager fermentation, and I think that's going to open up a whole lot of exciting possibilities as well.
Fantastic. Well, John, let's talk about home brewing lagers. What are some of the things that you have to do to start moving on to lagers?
Sure. Well, you know, I think that the one of the biggest challenges when people are looking to brew home, lagers, especially at home, is the temperature control. That is always the struggle for a lot of the brewers. To get down into the, 40s and 50s, it can be very challenging depending upon where you live and what you have access to. Fortunately, there's a lot of really great products out there. Some of them are handmade by the brewers. Other times you can purchase them at a pretty reasonable price to help, get those lagers to the brewing the fermenting temperature that you need them to get to. The brew jackets right now are something that a lot of people are using, which helps a lot. Internal thermometers is another thing that can be used. Even keezers, it is a situation where it's really important for that home brewer to be able to, get it to the right temperature for conditioning. I also feel like a lot of folks are bringing able to bring those temperatures down to the appropriate level, but also the challenge sometimes is also bringing it up to higher temperatures to give it a diacetyl rest, and so that's another challenge that people have. But there are some very reasonable products out there that are available to homebrewers, and some homebrewers are doing their own jerry rigs that are working quite effectively. I'm sure Dave knows of that himself too.
Well, Dave, can you walk us through some of those options?
Sure. I think the classic setup and the style that I run is taking an old chest freezer and overwriting the thermostat with a secondary temperature controller. So you place a probe inside of the freezer, and then you set the temperature that you want to ferment or lager at. You don't necessarily need the temperature controller if you just want to get started in lagers. A refrigerator can get you pretty close to freezing. So even if all you have is a kitchen thermometer, you could put it in the fridge for a day or so, check that you're 50 degrees or wherever it is that you want to ferment, run the fermentation, and then when you're ready to do the lagering, you can turn down the built-in thermostat and get it as close to freezing as that fridge will go, and do a lager even when you haven't yet acquired the temperature controller. So I think the temperature controlled environment is ideal. It gives you a lot more flexibility, but the lack of one shouldn't prevent an aspiring lager brewer to experiment with those styles.
Well, Dave, can you walk us through some of the other ones you mentioned? You mentioned some jackets as an option.
Jackets, you can, there are, cylindro-conical, stainless steel, fermenters that you can wrap jackets around. I believe there are cooling jackets that you can even wrap around a carboy. I'm not terribly familiar with those, but, the jackets offer a great option as well.
Well, a healthy lager yeast is very important as well, John. I was wondering if you could walk us through how to prepare your yeast and how much yeast you need.
Sure, and Dave's the expert on this part, but I can certainly add something, and he can expand on it. Is the one of the things you really should do if you're brewing a lager, as opposed to just pitching the yeast, you really should have a yeast starter. A lot of people do that regardless if it's an ale, lager, or other variety of beer, but with lagers, I feel like it's really important to get that yeast starter going. Typically you'll want to get a nice yeast starter going and not, like I said, directly pitch into it. Because that way the activity of the yeast will get going quicker. And oftentimes you'll be able to get, a better fermentation.
So, Dave, why do you need roughly twice as much yeast for a lager as for an ale?
Well, it really comes down to speed. Yeast work faster when they're warmer, and they work slower when they're colder. So if you're fermenting at anywhere from 45 to 55 degrees Fahrenheit, in order to move fermentation along and have a healthy fermentation, you need more yeast working slowly than you would for an ale, where you would have less yeast but working much faster. So having a larger pitch rate allows you to move things along and have a healthy fermentation. The other part of that is that it just overall results in a cleaner beer. You see with ales sometimes that if you underpitch, you'll get extra fruitiness or some unwanted off flavors. And having a large pitch ensures that you're going to have the cleanest fermentation that you possibly could.
So what kind of pitch rates do you use then, typically?
For my lagers, I typically aim for 1.5 to 2 million cells per milliliter per degree Plato. So that will translate into, if I'm using a healthy, fresh pack of yeast, that would translate into, a 2 to 3 liter yeast starter on a stir plate. What I'll often do for higher gravity lagers is I'll just go ahead and brew something lower gravity and just save all that yeast and use it as a big yeast starter. I've also become kind of a fan of the dry yeast because it's really easy to buy 2 packets of dry yeast and throw that in there properly rehydrated. And sometimes if I'm feeling lazy and the particular yeast strain doesn't matter so much, then I'll go the dry route.
Well, can you share with us some tips for ingredient selection?
You know, there's history and there's what you can do. And historically, lagers would have been continental European varieties, and so that would have implied continental Pilsner malts, Vienna malts, Munich malts, and as well as continental hops, the noble hops, and so forth. With lagers today, it really is just the fermentation that dictates it. So you're all over the map. For the India Pale Lagers, any of the newer American varieties that have found their way into IPAs, any of those are fair game. If you're looking at different malts, historically, if you were employing like a decoction mash or something for a historical style, then you might select an undermodified malt, but there's no real reason to do that unless you just want to experiment. So the malts and hop selections are really all over the place. The lager yeast really is the defining ingredient, and there's a lot of great strains available out there. Some are very temperature tolerant and can get you a decent lager, up approaching 60 degrees Fahrenheit, whereas some do work best in the mid 40s. So it really is a great time right now to be experimenting with lagers.
Now, John, I know some people are breaking down the traditional lager style guidelines and even creating new styles. What are some of the trends you're seeing?
Yeah, I'm seeing that too. In fact, there's a brewery in Massachusetts called Jack's Abbey, which I don't know about most of the country knowing about them yet because they're not heavily distributed, but they've done a really fantastic job in developing recipes that are for lagers that are extremely, I would say, creative. Specifically, they have an IPL and a double IPL and a porter that are all, obviously all lagers, and they do a tremendous amount of, positive things with these beers. And they've won, GABF awards and will continue to do that. They consistently rate extremely high and all the ratings, or whether it's with us or with other folks, they are also kind of taking an approach that is very unique because they're really taking a IPA approach to the lagers. What I mean by that is, they are not being afraid to add, a tremendous amount of hops, make very big high gravity beers, being very successful while doing it. The quality of beer that they're producing is amazing. I venture to guess we'll see a lot more breweries doing this because of the fact that the breweries are, you know, the field is so crowded now with over 3,000 breweries in the United States, to try to doing something that differentiates yourself from the rest is very important in order to be financially successful, but also to, you know, have people gravitate to your brewery and enjoy your beer. So they're doing a very good job by just focusing on, you know, one type of beer, which is lagers, but doing tremendous amount of varieties among those lagers in testing and creating lagers that people are loving. So, you know, I feel like that is something that that they're doing very effectively. Another, staying on the pro brewer track, New Belgium's doing a really interesting thing with lagers too. So they have over 60 fooders that they have at their brewery, and they create sour beers with those fooders, of which they only do exclusively lagers. And so they do not sour any ales, which is very untraditional. They call these two lagers Oscar and Felix, and they dedicate their entire sour beer program, which is very, very large, to souring lagers. And they're extremely successful and something that people are really loving too. So I think the cleanness of lagers, and then the challenge for the brewers, both home brewers and pro brewers, to create high quality lagers is really something that people are getting very interested in doing. And also the satisfaction of creating a good lager that people want to drink and can identify that, you know, this is done really high quality is something that, you know, is making folks really want to continue to brew them and continue to drink them.
Fantastic. Well, Dave, give us some tips on fermentation.
Well, the obviously the biggest one is temperature, and that starts at the very, very beginning of the fermentation process. And I would say if there's one thing that I would suggest, it is to ignore any suggestion of pitching at, you know, 70 degrees. Start with a huge pitch and pitch the yeast slightly below the fermentation temperature you actually want. So if you want to ferment at 50, plan to pitch 48 or so. And with that big pitch, you'll at a cold temperature, you'll minimize any chances for you know, fruity, more ale-like flavors. You'll have a much healthier fermentation. And you, in some cases, could avoid the diacetyl rest. I've personally found that the diacetyl rest can be skipped if I have a large enough and cold enough initial pitch. That said, I often frequently still do it just as insurance, because it doesn't hurt anything to do the diacetyl rest. So monitoring gravity during primary fermentation is also fairly key. The airlock is an okay indicator of fermentation in some cases, but with a lager being so cold and so sluggish relative to an ale, really taking gravity readings is the best way to kind of monitor the progress of your lager.
Let's talk for a minute about the diacetyl rest. How do you actually go about doing that?
So the diacetyl rest, diacetyl is a compound that shows up in really all beer. It's a byproduct of yeast fermentation, and it has what's commonly described as a kind of movie theater popcorn kind of buttery flavor. And it doesn't show up so much in ales because they're fermented warm enough that the yeast actually reabsorb the diacetyl they produce at those elevated temperatures. In a lager, the fermentation is all taking place in the 40s and 50s, and if any diacetyl is produced, in order for the yeast to reabsorb that, you either have to wait a long time because the yeast are going to be very sluggish, or when primary fermentation is almost over, I would say when you're within 10 gravity points, 5 to 10 gravity points of the end of primary fermentation, you can raise your fermentation temperature up to about 60 degrees, maybe 65 degrees Fahrenheit or so. And that'll just give the yeast a little nudge to go ahead and clean up after themselves before you start the actual.
You really go that high, huh? I was told only a few degrees typically.
I do go as high as 60 or 65. The reason I do that is that the flavor is pretty much locked in at that point once you're within, 5 or 10 gravity points of the end. So I aim for 60. If I overshoot it by 5, I don't really stress about it. And then I start bringing it back down after when I'm sure I've reached my final gravity. And, and a taste too. A taste is also a good way to tell. If you pull a sample and it tastes like butter, then you probably need to let it sit longer, or you need to elevate the temperature a little bit. And keep in mind too that diacetyl, you tend to taste it more as it warms up. So when you pull those samples, make sure they're warm enough that you'll actually be able to detect it.
John, why do we often require a little more time to age a lager than an ale?
Well, I think it goes back historically, and I would love for Dave to chime in too on this once I complete my thought. But, sure. I'm just kind of picturing in this cold German cave, where it's 40 or 50 degrees. The yeast, is not as active, and the lager yeast is not going to be as active. So as a result, it needs to be fermented longer for the yeast to do its thing. For example, where if you're talking about an ale yeast in Belgium, warmer temperatures, obviously going to ferment a lot quicker because the yeast is a lot more active and it's able to create the alcohol quicker. So that's generally, my sort of layman's approach to that, but I'm sure Dave can expand on that too.
Dave, do you want to chime in?
Sure. It's in the name. The name lager comes from the German lager, meaning to store something, and that's key to this family of beer styles. Is that the smoothness, the drinkability, the crispness comes from a long period of aging. German styles, German ale styles like Alt and Kolsch still get lagered, even though they're using an ale yeast. So the lagering process, the long cold nap, if you will, is sort of key to the beer's evolution. And you'll notice even with ales that you make, the longer they stay in cold storage, the more they get clearer and they smooth out, and they just taste better over time. So I think the early brewers in Germany realized that the longer you kept these things in cold areas, the better the beer tasted at the end. So it just sort of became part of that brewing process.
Well, I know we often get off flavors, especially in young lagers. What are some keys to getting through those off flavors and troubleshooting your lagers?
Sure. And lagers are very difficult, I think. I struggle with them myself in picking apart what I may or may not have screwed up in it. So we already talked a little bit about diacetyl. I think a key to avoiding that is a large cold pitch. And doing a diacetyl rest towards the end of primary fermentation. A lot of lagers, especially light lagers, have almost exclusively Pilsner malt. And if you're dealing with a large quantity of Pilsner malt, it's likely that you'll have some dimethyl sulfide, which is the kind of the corn flavor. Mm-hmm. And in some styles, that can be sort of appropriate, but generally it's considered an off flavor. And the best way to get rid of that is to boil longer. If I'm using a 100% Pilsner malt base, I'll boil for 2 hours because I live at 5,000 feet. I think if you're at sea level, you're fine with an hour and a half. But a long rolling boil, and don't cover the pot, and chill as quickly as you can. And that will go a long way towards avoiding the dimethyl sulfide. Sulfur comes up more in lager brewing than it does in ale. All yeast produce it, but at the cold temperatures, more sulfur is retained in solution. So you'll often have this horrific, rotten egg smell coming out of your fermenter, but most of the time, if you just leave it and go through the paces, the yeast will clean that up. And a small amount of sulfur, particularly in some of the lighter German styles, a little whiff of that isn't so bad. And then the other one is acetaldehyde, which is kind of described as like a green apple kind of flavor. And there are actually lager strains that produce that more than others. Probably the American lager strains are more notorious for it. And it's not necessarily an off flavor. It's just a product of the yeast. So if that's something that you don't like in your lager, then you might want to ferment that yeast strain just a little bit colder, and that should clear up any of that acetaldehyde.
So that covers some of the off flavors. John, I was wondering if you could share some tips on lager brewing.
Sure. And first, I'll give a couple tips on just a brew day, more general brew day, which and this is through my own experience too, is I'd recommend that when you're brewing, whether it's a lager or any beer, that you really dial back on the drinking. I know that's probably not going to be the most popular thing, at least until the latter part of the brewing process, because my other tip, which is really important, I feel, is recording your day. And so if you're drinking too much, then you might not have the best records in the world. What I mean by recording your day is really over-record, have a notebook or have, you know, a computer with you or an iPad or something like that, where you can record every aspect of the day. Some people get so particular about this, and these are some of the best brewers, home brewers that I've been around. They'll even record what music they're listening to, what the weather was like, anything like that, because, you know, the more information you have that you can look back on, and whether it was successful or unsuccessful batch of beer, I think the better off you are. And that also allows you to also keep very detailed notes around your recipes and, you know, the things you did, because sometimes when you're brewing, the exact recipe that you went into the brew with may not have been the exact recipe that you ended up doing too. So you want to make sure any adjustments to those recipes are something that's very clear. With regard to lagers specifically, one of the things I think is the biggest issue is making sure you have the proper knockout temperature for that lager. And, you know, sometimes that's a real challenge, but I do think, you know, that is critical. And for example, if you're using a wort chiller and your water only goes down, you know, the temperature of your water is only 65 degrees, then that can be very challenging to get down to the proper temperature. One of the things that, you know, people do is sometimes they'll put the wort in the refrigerator to get it down temperature before you pitch the yeast. That's something that a lot of is very popular and also something that's very effective. But there's, you know, some people that are doing really creative things too. Head brewer for Fort Collins Brewery, who I know, Adam, he actually created a glycol chiller. So he has a wort chiller, and then he has a secondary glycol chiller that he utilizes to get to that proper temperature. So, you know, there's a lot of folks that will walk out on this seriously, and other folks that will, you know, use the refrigerator or, you know, Keyser approach to it. But yeah, I think that knockout temperature is critical.
So you're saying get it all the way down before you pitch the yeast, right?
Exactly.
Now, what about aeration? Do you aerate your wort?
Yeah, I feel like that's a critical element too, in making sure that there's proper aeration with the wort. And if you don't do that, then you could definitely run into some trouble there too.
Okay, well, let's switch over to Dave. Dave, could you share some of your tips for making a perfect lager?
Sure. Just touching back on the aeration issue. So I always make sure that I get the wort down to pitching temperature before I aerate, because the cold wort will absorb more oxygen than a warmer wort. So the way I chill, I usually brew lagers in the winter. So you know, I'll have my brew day. I'll use my immersion chiller to get it as cold as I can, which is usually around 65 or so in the winter, and then I'll switch to a pond pump that I've in a cooler that I've filled with ice water, and I'll run ice water through the chiller, and that might get me another 5 or 10 degrees down, depending on how long I do it. And then if it's cold out and it's the evening, I will just put the fermenter up on my outside table covered and wait for nature to get it down to pitching temps, or I'll stick it in the lagering fridge if it's warm out. Then I wait for it to hit pitching temps. I don't worry too much about infection at that point with it being nice and cold. But sanitation, of course, you just need to pay extra attention to that. And then when it has reached pitching temps, then I will I actually use a pure oxygen cylinder with a diffusion stone to inject oxygen directly into the wort. A blast of that for about 90 seconds when it's nice and cold will get you a nice amount of oxygen, and then head straight into the pitching, close it up. And like I said, routine gravity readings, those first 3 or 4 days, you may not see any activity in your airlock because that cold wort is absorbing all the CO2 that's being produced. So a lot of beginning lager brewers worry that, my airlock's not bubbling, there must be something wrong, when in fact there's plenty of CO2 being produced. It's just all going into the wort at that point, or the beer rather.
Yeah, I've noticed that it does take longer generally for these to start.
It does. And I would say the biggest thing with lagers is to have fun with them and don't rush the process. Like, make sure if you're going to brew a lager that you have enough time to give it the attention that it needs, and really get the fundamentals down before you start messing around with more esoteric things. Decoction mashing and lagers go hand in hand historically. I like to play with decoctions from time to time, but if you're learning how to get your lagering process down, that's probably not the time to do it. Get the temperature part down. Make sure you can ferment a nice, clean lager before you start playing with other variables.
Now, that sounds like really good advice.
Yeah,
especially I've done a couple decoctions, and man, that can be a real mess, especially the first couple times.
It can, and it can be a lot of fun. It's I think a great way to engage with your beer on another level and sort of connect with history somewhat. But that's more of a because I want to thing than a because I need to thing. So it's not essential to do that to make a great lager.
No, not at all. Well, John, I was hoping you could talk for a minute about your new project, which is Craft Beer and Brewing Magazine.
Sure. This is a project that a lot of us have been working hard on for a while. As a craft beer enthusiast and a home brewer and the other folks that are involved are also, we really wanted to do something that was different for the industry and something that was very positively impactful. So we did launch a magazine called Craft Beer and Brewing back in March, and it's going along great, very well. It's a high quality publication with tons of content. Dave, who has been here today with us, is one of the contributing editors and a key component to our content, and has done a fantastic job. Highly knowledgeable, as I'm sure all of you have noticed. And also, we have a great website called beerandbrewing.com, and we have online education where we go over several different types of techniques and classes, along with videos. And we'll continue to grow our product offering as we feel we can deliver high quality content. For us, we're trying to create a product that is geared toward that craft beer enthusiast, the home brewer, and even the pro brewers have really gravitated to the magazine quite well. But it's about doing something for really the right reasons. Many of us have been in publishing for a long time, and I would say that sometimes we were working on things that we didn't have a genuine love for, even though we did our best and did a good job at it. This is something that is is definitely a project of passion, and something that we race to work every day to work with, because it's so fantastic. And the brewing community, the homebrew community, and the professional brewing community is so amazing and welcoming, and such a great community to be part of, that we're really happy to be with it. And I'll tell you that there's not a day go by that we have any regrets, because the way it's been received, and I'd say this, the way that we're producing this content, I feel like we're really making a nice impact on the craft beer industry, and we'll continue to do that in the future.
I was wondering if you could say a few words about your training courses. I've just started to browse them myself, but
sure.
It looks like you got a pretty extensive set of products that you're producing there.
Yeah, it is. And it's something that we're adding to every month. That's a new online education. So it's a platform that really hasn't been seen in the craft beer industry before. And it's something that we're really trying to create something that is very valuable to folks. It has a lot of video elements and slideshows and quizzes and other text elements.
No quizzes.
But it's
right.
It's meant to really be a class for folks to work through at their leisure, and with very, I think, price points that are very appealing to people that are not, at the same time, it's accessible, but it's also something that they can really, I think, sink their teeth into, that it has enough quality content that they'll continue to enjoy it and use it in the future. We add two classes every month, so that's something that's that we've been doing, and Dave is actually playing a critical part in that too, so we're thankful for that.
Well, Dave, I was wondering if you could add your thoughts.
Sure. Everyone
project.
that I Yeah, everyone that I show the print issue to is just nothing but impressed at not only the quality of the content, but just the eye for design. There's the it's just a well put together magazine and just sort of feels right in your hand. The paper's good quality. It's just a really nice product. But like John said, that's just one aspect of the whole project. And one of the things that I find really interesting is sort of connecting. I'm kind of a beer history nerd, so I obviously have interest in historical styles and, you know, old ways of doing things. And I enjoy connecting those to what new brewers are doing and new ideas that are coming about. And I think the online educational platform is kind of a great way to do that, because the target audience, the person you're trying to teach something to, they may be interested in creating, the latest, greatest double IPA, but they need to, you need to know how to run before you can walk. And so the courses, I think, are a great way to kind of instill some of that base level knowledge that then enables you to move on and do really interesting things with your homebrew. So like John said, the we're doing two courses a month, and they we're covering a wide variety of topics. And if you're not the sort of person who tends to pick up a book to learn something, I think this is a really great way to really see it demonstrated and to engage with the content as well.
I appreciate you doing it. John Palmer and I have been working on just two videos recently. Yeah. And that was a huge amount of work. So I appreciate how much work goes into something like this.
Sure.
Yeah. And your videos have been, I'll tell you, they're super well done and fantastic. So the time and energy you put into it definitely shows on those too.
Yeah. I'm still working on the second one, but I hope to get it out next month. But anyways, I wanted to also mention that you John, have been a big supporter of BeerSmith and a sponsor of BeerSmith and the podcast, and I really appreciate that as well.
Oh, it's our pleasure to be associated with you. Your customers, too, who some of them are our customers now, are fantastic people, and they're highly dedicated and super engaged, so we're just happy to be associated with you in any way, shape, or form. We appreciate that.
Well, thank you. And while I got you on here, I'm going to mention the offer code you gave, BeerSmith, right?
That's absolutely still in effect. Yeah.
So if you go to the website, which I've got up here, is beerandbrewing.com, and you want to subscribe to the new magazine, you can do that just out here on the right side. And if you enter the offer code BeerSmith in the coupon code, you'll get a 20% discount, right?
That is correct. Yeah, that's an exclusive offer for the BeerSmith folks, and we hope you guys enjoy it.
Well, thank you, John. I really appreciate you being on the show. And do you have any closing thoughts? Is there anything else you want to add?
No, we just, like I said, we're really happy to be here. I hope that folks have learned some things about lagering today. And if they have any questions for us, feel free to reach out directly. Just go on our website at beerandbrewing.com and shoot us an email. We'll be happy to answer them. We're a very small company that, like I said, is highly engaged and would love to get to know you guys more. And any questions or concerns you might have, we'd be happy to answer.
Yeah, and I've been impressed with the quality of the content you guys are putting out, not only in the magazine, but online as well. Just fantastic.
Well, thanks. Thanks, Brad.
And Dave, I wondered if you had any closing thoughts.
I just think this is the perfect time in history to be excited about lager again. I think much of craft beer has been very ale-centric, as maybe a reaction against mass-produced lager, but brewers and homebrewers are learning that you can make a really great lager and that it tastes nothing like what your granddad might have been drinking. So I think, if you're excited about lagers, this is a great time to be a homebrewer. And thanks for having us.
So when I have friends come over and ask me how to make Bud Light, what do you tell them?
go down to the store and pick it up if that's what you'd like.
That's what I usually do, yeah. I don't.
You get new friends.
I occasionally, it's happening less and less though, thank God, but I occasionally have people come over and ask for some of those traditional beers.
Yeah.
Anyways, thank you again for being on the show. Really appreciate you both being here. John, thank you.
Thank you, Brad.
And Dave, it's been great having you on the show as well. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks very much, Brad. This has been great. I really enjoyed it.
So again, today, my guests were John Bolton, who is president and CEO of Craft Beer and Brewing Magazine. He previously built a large, successful magazine publishing business in 2007, but now he's made the transition over to doing beer, which is a fantastic thing to do. And Dave Carpenter, of course, contributing editor for Craft Beer and Brewing Magazine, is an MIT grad in aeronautical engineering, who gave up all of that to pursue a career in writing and homebrewing, much like I did, actually. Did you know that, Dave?
I did know that, yes.
I used to be a rocket scientist, and I gave that up so I could do this.
Well, I'm hoping we're inspiring the students of tomorrow with our shenanigans.
Absolutely. Who thought I could make a living doing this, right?
I know.
Anyways, thank you both for being on the show. Really appreciate you being here.
Thank you very much.
Our pleasure. Thank you.
Well, a big thank you to John Bolton and Dave Carpenter for appearing on this week's show. And thank you to our sponsors, Craft Beer and Brewing Magazine, the new magazine on beer brewing. Get a 20% discount for your subscription by going to beerandbrewing.com and using the discount code BeerSmith when you check out. And also the American Homebrewers Association forum at homebrewersassociation.org. Join 22,000 fellow brewers talking about beer and homebrewing. It's free to sign up today at homebrewersassociation.org. And finally, BeerSmith Mobile, available for your phone or mobile device. Grab the BeerSmith Mobile app from iTunes, Google Play, or the Amazon App Store today. Thank you for listening, and I hope you have a great brewing week.